Well, it's great to be back with you for another GoldSeek.com Radio Gold Nugget segment. My special guest today, Charles Goyette, best-selling author and radio host. Charles Goyette penned a New York Times bestseller as well as his latest Red, Blue, and Broke All Over, Restoring America's Free Economy, currently editor of the Freedom and Prosperity Letter. Hello, Charles Goyette.
Chris, great to speak with you again, and please mention the work that I do with Ron Paul, the weekly podcast, daily radio commentaries. Those are accessible at podcastone.com, the weekly podcast.
Very good. We'll have the links up, and I guess we'll discuss that a bit more in detail at the end of the discussion today.
Great.
Well, let's start off with the gold market. You know, you note that demand for physical gold is booming, and you liken the impact of the gold market on financial markets to that of tectonic plate shifts, or more colloquially known as earthquakes. Tell us how this could send reverberations across, the markets.
Well, to extend the geologic metaphor, I think what we're really seeing is a huge, unnoticed, for the most part, subterranean flow of precious metals from the West, from Europe and the United States, to the Orient, to China. This is going on under the nose of the American people who are, you know, indifferent and in a state of neglect about all monetary issues. But in the Far East, in places from India to China, they take their money very seriously, and they take precious metals as money more seriously still. So we are seeing in real terms, in terms of not fiat money, but real money, we are seeing a gradual decapitalization of the West and a recapitalization of the Far East. And this spells a change, which I liken to a tectonic plate shift, a change in the dominance and influence of the affairs of humankind going forward from the Western world to the Eastern world. I'm not telling you that that's a bad thing necessarily, that the contributions of the Eastern world may not at some point surpass what we have accomplished here in the West. But I will tell you that if you live in the West and you see your fortunes diminishing, you see your lifestyle will be going down, you know that the end of the dollar reserve standard around the world means a lessening of your standard of living as well and the purchasing power of your currency.
Well, we're certainly seeing the golden magma flow from the West to the East, but you know, we're not seeing that flow. It's blocked, apparently, in the Atlantic, under the Atlantic Ocean there, maybe in one of the trenches. It's pooling because, for some reason, the Bundesbank can't get its gold back, no matter how hard it tries. So, you know, we're hearing that they only received 5 tons of gold. That may sound like a lot. They're recasting all gold bars that return. There are some rumors that there may be some tungsten-filled bars. And now, at this current pace, 5 tons, that is, a year, we're looking at 60 years to repatriate gold that should have already been returned in total. I'd like your thoughts on this.
Yes, the plot thickens. And I actually, Chris, resent this a great deal because over the years, in calling for what are simply prudent business measures that every hair salon in America would take to audit their books, to double-check the figures, and so on and so forth, have been cast as quackery when recommended for the Federal Reserve. You cannot get an honest audit of the Federal Reserve or the gold holdings of the United States, and people like myself and yourself, I presume, that have raised this issue have been diminished by being referred to as, you know, tinfoil hat wearers and so on and so forth. This is extremely frustrating that the most basic of business prudency can't be applied to the largest financial enterprise on the face of the planet or in the history of mankind, the Federal Reserve. And I have encountered this in the form of belittling comments or remarks. What do you think, Charles, that somebody backed up a truck in the middle of the night and took the gold out? No. But as we are becoming more and more curious, it appears that there may be multiple claims. You know, when you do an audit, it's not just counting the bars to make sure that all the bars are there. You would, in fact, check to spot check them to see if, indeed, there are any bars with tungsten. You would actually, even more importantly, in my view, find out if title to them is clear or if it has been compromised, if that gold has been used as a part of unaudited financial operations, if it has been pledged, used in loans, in swap arrangements, and other financial shenanigans. And so, of course, we don't know exactly why Germany can't get its gold back and what the delay is. It sure raises suspicions that there is something amiss because they have so mightily resisted the basics of business prudency in the form of an audit for so long. Our suspicions are doubled.
It's not just that central bank that has its own concerns about the purity of the bullion that's returning or being repatriated. Now the BOC, the Bank of China, is recasting all of its gold bars. Why can't the Federal Reserve and the Treasury simply step into the market and slowly accumulate these bars if they don't want to send the bars that are supposedly in their vaults and send that to Europe? Calls on the COMEX exchange or the Shanghai exchange ensure that Germany will receive its metal. Something doesn't pass the smell test here.
Let's look at it carefully because the central banking is built on the basis of one presupposition, and that presupposition, the entire philosophy undergirding central banking is fractionalism, fractional reserve banking. So are we to be surprised if the edifice is built on the concept of fractional reserve banking, that multiples of deposits can be loaned out because depositors won't all line up at once? It's the law of large numbers that some will come in to redeem their deposits, but they all won't line up. Therefore, we can make hay by loaning their money out over and over again. Are we to be surprised if fractionalism or fractional reserve banking is not employed by the central banks of the world as well? Well, of course it is. So with respect to gold, they've gotten away with this, whatever their monetary practices are or their lending practices with gold, for a very long time without oversight, for a very long time without audit. Are we suddenly surprised to think that, they may have actually compromised the title by using it to secure more transactions than there is actual gold in the vaults to secure? I mean, the United States has a history of this. The United States has been floating bad checks around the world for a very long time. We got caught up in 1971 when Richard Nixon realized we had issued so many bad checks promising that they were redeemable. The United States was doing it to countries all over the world, and when they lined up to redeem those checks at the gold window, there was no gold.
Hugo Chavez, one of his last edicts was the repatriation of all of Venezuela's gold. Lesser known is that Mexico is requesting back its gold. Obviously, the Bundesbank sent most of its gold to Paris, London, and New York due to the Red Scare several decades earlier. That's no longer seen as a threat. Is the new scare rehypothecation, swapping and leasing? I'd like your thoughts.
Well, I can tell you that the rhetoric that the gold standard is outdated, that it's forgotten, that nobody cares about it, that it's a relic of the past, and so on, is eyewash for the public. Because the truth is that governments in the real world never go off the gold standard. You saw the story, no doubt, a week or so ago, that in the middle of the night, faced with Russians intent on securing their position in Crimea, that the new government of Kiev loaded up an airplane. Their details included how many men, how many cars, how many trucks, loaded up an airplane in the middle of the night with the central bank's gold, and delivered by cars that had had trucks that had had their license plates removed, and men in black uniforms with no insignia or identifying marks on them, and flew it off in the middle of the night with not so much as a public how do you do to the United States for safekeeping. Now, they did not secure the pallets of their failing national currency, did they? Or the currency printing presses or printing plates, for that matter. No, when in the real world, when in faced with a crisis and a desire for resources, in the real world, governments always look to gold, and they always secure their deals. When Germany loans money to Portugal, they ask secretly for security in the form of gold. So, you know, this is for the public. The idea that that gold does no longer have a part of our monetary system. We see the proof is in the pudding, and in the pudding, it's even the governments themselves and the central banks in a crisis want gold first.
Were I the leader, I would have gone for London or even Paris. I wouldn't have even considered the United States, given the track record with the Bundesbank. But there has been some speculation in the blogosphere that perhaps this entire event, or at least an aspect of this event, the tensions between, I'm referring to Ukraine, Crimea, and of course Russia, may have been fomented as an attempt to extricate the gold from that nation. I mean, we're no longer on such tense terms with Russia, the United States. Is that too far out?
I don't know that it's too far out, but with respect to why they would ship the gold to the United States, it's clear to me that the authorship of the entire revolution is the handiwork of the United States. Victoria Nuland has admitted as much. Billions of dollars spent, the taxpayers' money spent on fomenting revolution and toppling the government in Ukraine. We have, you know, a former senior analyst of the CIA told me the other day, he said the things that CIA operations used to do with respect to the Mossad government, for example, in Iran or Guatemala or whatever it may be, are not done by operations of the CIA now. They're done by the National Endowment for Democracy. And so we have 60 National Endowment for Democracy type operations that have been ongoing in Ukraine at the cost. Well, Russia's estimate is that we've been spending, I believe they think we're spending $5 million a week to subvert conditions in Ukraine. So we are clearly the authors of the situation there. And if you have any doubt about that, all you have to do is go listen to the tape of Assistant Secretary of State Veronica Nuland. It's the tape that the media cared about because she used a four-letter word. But the media did not seem to bestir itself about the propriety of the United States Assistant Secretary of State and the ambassador to Ukraine choosing who would be the next head of state. With an election looming this spring and designating among a populist candidate, somebody the people loved, and a central banker that the United States loved, and another candidate still, among them designating, "We want Yats," said Nuland. "We want, no, Yats is our guy. The other guys are going to have to clip their wings and just get in line, and Yats is our guy." And 2 weeks later, lo and behold, Yats is in charge. And the plot thickens. We had, you know, this is also an unverified story, but it has a fair amount of currency, and there may be truth to it. I suspect where there's some smoke, there's something else going on. Purportedly, the prime minister, I believe, of one of the Baltic republics, and it may have been Estonia, told commissioner of the European Community that the sharpshooters, the snipers that were in Liberty Square in Kiev, that were shooting people, that how many people died in that short-lived revolution? About 60 people were shot. That the shooters, the sharpshooters, the snipers in that event were shooting people on both sides without regard to their alliance, because the objective apparently, and we know this technique has been used many, many times in history, if you want to bestir people into a revolution, you start, you know, creating some casualties and hardening people's positions and angering the mobs and so on, purportedly shooting people from both sides. And the head of the European Community said, well, I'm going to have to look into that. That would be great if they looked into that. I would love to get the information on it. But who benefits from it? Russia didn't want it. Who has the resources that has been fomenting revolutions like that anyway?
And this story goes back. I mean, there's some teeth to this. We're talking decades that Wall Street benefited and financed both sides of the conflict from. So there was money to be made. War is a racket.
It was Smedley Butler, General Smedley Butler. Of course it's a racket. And one has to only look up Operation Northwoods here in the United States to realize that people at the highest levels of the United States government were perfectly willing to kill American civilians, innocent American citizens, to create a pretext for war with an enemy. What, an invasion of Cuba? Can't justify it. Let's kill a bunch of Americans and claim that Cuba did it, and then we'll have a pretext for war. This got through the chairman of the Joint Chiefs.
But now we read in the Telegraph this week, this could end up as a new Cold War. And of course, there's money to be made there.
You know, you have a defense budget, an ever-growing defense budget that has to be justified. So let me ask you, I mean, if your objective was to start a new Cold War, I suppose, well, let me ask you some of the things that you might do. Would you think about instead of dismantling your Cold War military alliance? With the Cold War ended, do you think you might even expand it, even though it was created to fight the Warsaw Pact, to check the Warsaw Pact, which nobody exists? Do you think you might actually extend and grow your military alliance? Do you think, in fact, you might expand it right onto your designated enemy's doorstep, despite your own assurances at the time that if they would remove their troops from Germany and let Eastern Europe go free, that you would not expand NATO? Do you think you might expand it to their doorsteps if you wanted a new Cold War? Do you think you might ramp up your military budget all out of proportion to any reality? Do you think you might spend hundreds of millions of dollars on operations that are designed to stir up the factions in countries next door on the border of your intended enemy? And for all your talk of democracy in response to a referendum that you didn't like anyway, you didn't like the outcome, do you think you might institute trade sanctions of the kind that are always a prelude to more trouble down the road? Do you think you would do things like that if you wanted to foment a new Cold War? I suppose those are the sorts of things you might do.
And you might just improve that sluggish employment situation in your country, and you might increase your gross domestic product, which has also been lackluster, and it might offset some of China's slowing growth that has everybody nervous with their manufacturing sector. Shift back to the precious metals, more specifically, you know, some analysts are pegging the cost of mining silver at around $20 an ounce. But prices were below that level for quite some time, and we're also seeing record demand for silver coins from the U.S. Mint, which has really quadrupled recently. One source claiming silver mine production was disrupted, though, due to those mining costs we talked about. How significant do you think this disruption in mining may be? I mean, have we closed enough mines? Has production been reduced enough to where we might see a sustainable rally just on its own merits?
Well, I will tell you, Chris, I'm very, very bullish on silver. And I only have one piece of insight that I will share with your listeners to justify that. You have seen with the depressed price of silver, as far as it has fallen and so on, for the length that it has fallen, you have seen the price of silver assimilating the depression in Europe and the slowdown in China now for the last couple of years. And this is what markets are prone to do, is to discount conditions as they are in development. On the other hand, you have what I view, the price of silver has been a reflection of its industrial quality, but you cannot look at silver the way you can look at almost anything else in the economy, because it has a longer monetary history than even gold. And if you will remember, and I know you will, I know this from being up close, in fact tangentially related to the story, it only took, I was going to say a handful, I'm going to say a dozen, fewer than a half a dozen billionaires around the world to awaken to the monetary virtues of silver in an era of reckless fiat monetary policies. Only less than a half a dozen billionaires around the world to begin to view silver as a monetary commodity to send its price through the roof. And I believe that the evidence is very clear that something like this is happening again. I don't identify for you, and I don't think that they have anybody has stepped forward on a program like this. But you see evidence that the world is awakened to silver's monetary virtues. It's very slim. It's just a glimmer on the horizon. But you know, as the government of India tried to quash interest in gold, it stampeded people in India to silver as a monetary commodity, as a reaction to monetary conditions. In addition to that, we have the amazingly robust sales of silver coins that you alluded to earlier. This is a reflection of a psychology or an understanding of silver by the people, the strong hands. Mind you, these are strong hands who buy these things, because these buyers of silver intend to hold it. They are not hedge funds that buy this and then they're on to iPhones next week and so on and so forth. They're not momentum chasers. Clearly, they're strong hands, and it sounds funny for me to tell people that the hedge fund buyers of, for example, gold or silver for that matter, are weak holders, but the people that are buying gold in China James Rickards, the Currency Wars author, with whom I share a publisher, says, you know, that gold goes to China, it goes underground where it is kept for the next 300 or 400 years.
That's right.
These are strong holders, whereas the holders in the United States, the hedge funds and the ETFs, are weak holders because they will sell it in a moment for a margin call for something else or for a new opportunity. So you see that with silver. Now, my view is that the silver coin buying is not enough in the total volume to move the market individually as much as to indicate to us a changing psychology about silver, just as India is. But there's one more piece of evidence. If you look at the ETF holdings of gold and silver, I think there were 700 tons of gold that moved out of ETFs in the last couple of years.
It all went to China. You're right.
And it all went to China. But if you look at the chart of silver holdings at the ETFs, they actually, it's during part of that period, they rose, and for the most part, they were flat. While gold was precipitously lower, silver holdings of ETFs remained flat or actually trended just a bump or two higher. I think this is enormously significant because those holders of silver are not commodity buyers that are using it to make electronics next month or a year down the road. They don't have an industrial demand for it and so on. This is something else entirely. This represents a new slow awakening of people to the idea that in an era thick with monetary risk, that silver has performed admirably for many thousands of years.
Other reports are showing that the London gold fix may be broken. This, of course, was the standard used by the industry, insiders, central banks, to value the price of gold. Some sources are saying, though, that it's just been manipulated for too long. There are some investigations underway. We're basically looking at Barclays, Deutsche Bank, Bank of Nova Scotia, HSBC, and Société Générale, suspected of manipulating this $20 trillion gold market. The rate setting began in 1919. We're coming up on the 100-year anniversary of the process. Is this a significant piece of the puzzle?
Do they manipulate interest rates? Do we know, for example,
the LIBOR?
Of course, they manipulated LIBOR. Have you ever seen, I think Adam Smith's line was, you know, you don't get two businessmen together before they, you know, start to conspire against the public interest and to enrich themselves. I've never believed the propriety of the London gold fix. I've always been suspicious about that. But my view is, and having lived, as I said, through the Bunker Hunt silver episode and watched the exchanges operate as partisans of their board members into one side of the market versus impartiality with regard to buyers and sellers, I believe that all of these markets and quasi-market institutions of this sort, institutional markets like this, are fixed. And perhaps I'm wrong, but I think people are armed if they are justly suspicious that they may be. And so my assumption is, you go into it, you assume that they're conspiring on their own behalf rather than yours.
And as we wrap up here today, you know, we do have an FOMC meeting slated. I wanted to get your thoughts on the new Fed chair, Dr. Yellen, as well as all of the concerns over tapering. You know, we've seen a bit of a tick up in the unemployment rate that was unexpected, not anything significant, but we're still shy of that 6.5% target rate at the Fed. So I kind of like your thoughts on whether or not you expect them to pull in the reins somewhat on the stimulus, or are they really holding a weak hand and the river card will essentially show us, well, we need more stimulus. What do you think?
Yeah, they may continue another month or so, but I think they're very reluctant to continue it much longer. If you look at Yellen, if you look at the addition of the vice chairman now, Fisher, you know, these people are back-to-the-wall inflationists. But you're right, the employment numbers are nothing but confusing. I think even more significant is, in the face of a China slowdown that is becoming something more than a slowdown and is becoming increasingly apparent to everyone, this is like an ocean liner that goes down and sucks in everything around it. I mean, the eddies and the currents of destruction around the sinking of China could be very, very great indeed. And it has implications for the United States and our economic resiliency as well, not to mention, you know, questions that we're talking about, the funding of American debt and so on. So I think that, you know, that in public pronouncements, you know, they would like to assume the posture that they are confident in the decision that they have embarked upon to continue to taper. But I am not in the least convinced. I think that every fiber of their Keynesian beings is screaming for more money pumping, because they know very well that the China situation is real, that the unemployment situation remains to be seen, and that the American economy, not to mention the movement of $104 billion out of foreign holdings of U.S. treasuries at the Federal Reserve this past week.
No, I think it's well said. You know, I think we're entering that neoclassical nightmare, the worst of world scenario that I refer to as stagflation, because that's where the models break down. You don't want to be in a situation where stimulus just doesn't have the impact that it did before. It loses its efficacy. And I think that's where we are, inflation. Okay, I'm watching the grocery bills going up. I'm watching tuition bills go up, rent bills, everything. Everything's going through the roof.
Well, you just look at the Tuesday morning, the front page of the Tuesday morning Wall Street Journal. Arabica coffee up, I think, 49.5%. In the last, just since the first of the year, we're talking, Chris, less than 3 months. And it goes on, you know. It's cattle, it's hogs, it's sugar, it's corn, it's wheat, it's just about every food commodity out there. And of course, it's a mistake for people to say, you know, to confuse inflation and price inflation, to say that there's no inflation if there's no consumer price inflation. We know there's inflation because classical economists and long history says inflation is an increase in the supply of money and credit. It does not have to manifest at once in consumer prices. It can perfectly well manifest in the cost of insurance or medical care, of education, the cost of government, on Wall Street and the bond market, which we've experienced this time. But that money is beginning to leak out, and it's beginning to become available at the level of consumer prices. Now there will be a stampede into the markets that we've been talking about.
If we bring this together, the inflation we're referring to, as well as this stubbornly high unemployment number, I mean, the Fed's excited because we're under 7% unemployment. The labor participation rates at the St. Louis Fed, it's abysmal. It's a sinkhole, and the house is already missing. That worst of world scenario where the stimulus is not working as expected, and you have unbelievably higher rates, not just rates, but inflation, as you referred to, they still have to keep rates low, which is becoming increasingly expensive, requiring massive credit default swaps and other instruments behind the scenes, working through J.P. Morgan and others. But then you still have a huge number of people, tens of millions of people, who are eligible to work but cannot find meaningful work. They're accepting jobs that are simply insufficient. Now, why don't you tell folks a bit more about this exciting show you have with former Congressman Ron Paul, Dr. Paul, as well as your latest bestseller, please.
Well, we do a twice-a-day radio commentary. We're on well over 100 radio stations around the country, twice a day, morning and afternoon drive, on events going on. It's a wonderful thing for people that have been hearing, you know, the conventional wisdom about news and economics and government and what's going on, to get a chance to hear a different perspective every day when they shower, every day when they pick up the kids after school or drive home, every day, day after day after day, instead of being propagandized by the conventional statist view that we all expect from the mainstream media, to get a different perspective on things. So if your local radio station doesn't carry Ron Paul's daily commentary, you ought to rattle somebody's chain there and get them to do so, and do your friends and neighbors in your community a favor. In addition to that, though, we do a once-weekly podcast. The Ron Paul Weekly Podcast is available at a website called Podcast One. Podcast One, O-N-E, podcast1.com. And, Chris, you're the first person I've told outside of friends and family that beginning this coming week, we are expanding the Ron Paul Weekly Podcast enormously, turning it, because of people's hunger for news and information, the podcast has proved to be quite popular, and we're expanding it enormously with new additional content, and quite excited about it. So you can find it at podcast1.com.
Well, hat tip for all of that. I mean, we're getting the information out there. That's really exciting. And the more folks that become aware, you know, hopefully the less detrimental to society as this entire house of cards implodes in the next few years. So we're going to look forward to having you back on the show here.
Thank you, Chris. Always good to talk to you.